So what is Belmont? And I'm just going to tell you a little bit about us as a company to introduce what we're going to speak about. So Belmont is a reasonably small luxury hotel company. We have hotels, trains, and cruises. And we're based really globally. We have about 8,000 employees and an EBITDA of 120 million. Now, I joined Belmont in 2014 and came from a much larger organization. So when I started at Belmont, I realized that we had a lot of work to be done to become a real global aligned organization. Now, before you start working on a global aligned organization, you need to kind of determine what is your strategy for the next 5 years. So in the first couple of months, we changed the CEO, the COO, and myself was new. And we then, as a team, set out three main objectives for the period 16 to 2020. We said we would double the company in size. We would double the EBITDA. And we would make sure that all of you would know what Belmont is, so who we stand for. So really work on the brand recognition. Now, it's easy to say this stuff in a meeting room. Because when you sit in a meeting room, this sounds all quite okay. But then when you take a step back and you say, what is it actually that we need to do to get there? You come to a listing of more or less 36 major projects. When we realized that, we said, okay, this was an organization that was asleep for years. A fantastic organization, but nothing really changed. So when we decided to go on this big path of transformation, we realized the only way we could do this is when we would build resilient individuals and a resilient organization. Now, what does that mean when you have resilience as an organization? First of all, you need to have a strong sense of shared purpose. You all need to be aligned. This is what we want to do. The second thing is, you need to have a certain leadership style. And we'll get back to that later in the presentation. What is it that you need from your leaders to do? And third thing is, and that was something that was missing big time, you need to have a culture of accountability and trust. So thinking back on the strategy of what we said, the best way to communicate a new global strategy is if you actually get your entire top leadership of the organization together. Now, for some of you, many of the things that I say may sound totally natural. That is something that you've been doing for years. We, as an organization, did not. So this was new. We got together all our general managers, all our senior leaders, and because we're not that large, we're talking about 150 people. And we got them together in one of our properties in Madeira. And what we did there, for the first time ever, we gave them aligned corporate communication and presentation. So we all talked about the same thing. We created a real buzz in the organization, which paid off big time. What else did we do? We focused a lot on a culture of trust, a culture of accountability, and a culture of engagement. And again, when you look at this beautiful drawing up here, it just shows how in a company, if all the departments do not work together and there is no good collaboration, you as an HR professional can try whatever you want to, but you're never going to get an organization that moves forward hand in hand. So big focus on working together. So we wanted to get rid of the silos. So the two main areas that we started to concentrate on when you talk about the cultural transformation is the organizational structure and the organizational culture. And I just want to talk you through a few things that we focused on in the company. So when I got there in 2014, and this may sound very strange to you, I was only the second HR leader in that organization ever. And the organization had been in place for 37 years. There was no HR organization. So the lady who was there before me did great, great work because she put the basics in place. And when I came in, I took what she started and then started to build. Now, if you want to build an employee value proposition, you need to build a lot of tools to do so. So we laid out a plan. So as of 2016, we kind of listed what we wanted to do in 2016. And that was then followed what we were going to do in 2017. An enormous amount of work, but absolutely crucial to get the basics in place to be able to get to that state of a resilient organization that works hand in hand to transform the business. I just wanted to show you this because this gives you a bit of a feeling of the type of projects that we were doing and the type of technology that was involved in that. Because nowadays, whatever you do, there's a huge influence of technology, and also in the hotel business there is. Just think about it. When you call a reservation center, the person that answers the phone doesn't sit in the property. Yet, they're able to answer every single question you have about a specific room in that hotel. That requires a pretty robust system behind the scenes where they can look everything up, right? And then we started on the biggest thing, which was, let's look at the global organization and let's see how are we working. Because till then, we had 45 hotels, trains and cruises, and they all worked individually. Really well, but not together. So we had guests, and to give you a couple of names that maybe you may recognize, the train, the Venice Simplon Orient Express, you know that train that goes from Venice to London? That's ours, okay? Hotel Cipriani in Venice is ours. Rio Copacabana Palace is ours. So we've got some nice, really luxury properties. But they all worked individually. So when I started, I visited everything, so not too bad, okay? Nice places to go to. And I can recommend Machu Picchu, okay? Very nice property on the top, just at the entrance. But what I realized is I met many guests on my travel, and they were telling me they'd gone on the train, the Venice Simplon Orient Express, they'd been to Brazil, they'd gone to Iguazu, but they had no idea this was all the same company. They just stayed there because they enjoyed the properties. Now think, when you think business, what a lost opportunity. A lost opportunity in being able to recognize the guest and give them what they like, and a lost business opportunity, because the cross-selling can be much better. So we looked at our corporate organization and said, okay, how can we align all those different departments that they work together, but then also align with what we do in the operations, so in the hotels, in the regions, in the divisions, et cetera, et cetera. That was a huge undertaking. But then we also said, okay, with those 36 major projects, all of us had a full-time job. Now, how do you run 36 projects next to that? That's quite a bit of work. So we created a small project management office. So there are three people there that use a certain methodology that I'm sure many of you have. It's not Six Sigma, but something similar. And they use that to drive the change step by step throughout the company. And again, this is all new. They never ever work together across the globe. Last but not least, when I started, I was asking about the bonus system and said, okay, so what are the drivers for a bonus system? How do we determine if a general manager who runs a property, and a property has 600-700 staff, how do we know whether he or she gets a bonus? And that was purely financially driven. Now, it's understandable, but there is a lot of other drivers that you need to look at. So we changed the entire system, went online, and started doing some succession planning. Succession planning was another interesting one, because what had happened in the past is people were hired for a position. They were not hired for their potential. So we changed the way that we were recruiting and doing that. When we then looked at the organization, we said, since we've never done something as an overall organization, how can we involve everybody in the organization in determining our core values? So what we did is we had in every single business we had, we asked them to come up with their core values. So across the globe, we had 850 people involved in determining what they felt Belmont stood for. So this was not a corporate thing, not top-down, it was bottom-up. And that bought us so much credit that when we rolled it out, it was like this, it was easy. And you see later when I show you the results of our employee survey, that's what they rate highly. So we did everything bottom-up. Now, once you decide what your internal culture is, you need to align your internal culture and your external culture. So our brand guy started to build a brand house. We call this the House of Belmont. Now, I've taken out all of the text because he hasn't officially announced this, but what you do is the basis of the house are your core values. What do your people do? What do they stand for? And then you start working on what is your personality as a brand? How do you want people to see you? What benefit do we give your customer? The emotional benefit, the purpose, and the vision. So everything we had started to do was, as a company, cross-departmental, cross-functional in building this organization. We're now, actually Thursday, which is tomorrow, right? Tomorrow we're doing the pilot of the training that's going to roll out that brand feeling. We call that the service culture training. Because we can design in corporate what we want to do, but how do you get every single employee to do the same thing? That's what we're starting with the pilot tomorrow. And then we said, okay, great. We know what our core values are, we're working on our brands, we've got new systems. How are we going to make sure that the people that we recruit have similar skills? So what is important for us? So we went through the same exercise as we did with the core values. We went to every single business and asked the business, what is it important that your leader has? What qualities do you believe your leader needs to have? And again, that is how we built bottom-up our six leadership competencies. I'm sure very similar to all of yours, but that's how we did it. And because we did it bottom-up, it got the buy-in again. And there's a lot of other behaviors behind this, obviously, but those are the six. And then we built tools, processes, and key performance indicators based on all of that. So we looked at what is it that we want to achieve as a company? What leadership competencies do we want people to have? What kind of culture do we want to have? And we took a step back and said, okay, in HR, how can we add value to the organization? Because we're not a silo, we're not a separate department, we're integrated in the business. And that's what we started to do. So all of this stuff that you see here is pretty much new. So it's all rolled out, but it's pretty much new. But as we said already, transformation is really a team effort. If you want to have a resilient organization, you need to do that together as a team. And you need to be pretty sure what you expect from your leaders. So I found a quote which, to me, really brought it home. And this quote says that nearly one-third of your financial performance as a business is based on how your leaders operate. And when I tell our leaders that, they're always there like, yeah, yeah, whatever. But then I always use an example and say, just imagine that your direct manager really treats you unfairly. When you go back to your office, are you going to be highly productive? Of course not. So that counts at every level in the organization, because a hotel business is like any of your businesses. We have operational staff, but we also have legal departments and IT departments and commercial departments and revenue and sales and HR. We have all of these people as well. So, what is leadership? Now, when I have a small group, I usually ask people, shout me some things out. That might be a bit difficult with this group here now. But leadership has many, many aspects. And let me show you a few. And I highlighted a few because I think there are a few very important ones. The ability to practice active listening. Not just hear and sit there, but actively listen. Really try to understand what people are telling you. Humility. I think in the past, no one would ever have said that is a quality of a good leader. Now I think 95% of the people understand that's a big quality. Taking accountability, huge part of leadership. It's not the person next door that's making the mistake. You need to take accountability. In a resilient organization, that's one of your key things you need to have. Stand up for what you've done wrong, and then move on. Make it better, improve it, and move on. Have a vision. Incredibly important. Know where you want to get to. KPIs, also important. And then the importance of emotional intelligence and the AQ quotient, which is called adversity quotient, which is resilience. So there is three things in leadership that are important. Your IQ, your EQ, and your AQ. So what is IQ? Now, IQ is easy. That's what you have. You can't improve your IQ. It is what it is. It kind of develops itself till your teens, 13, 14, and that's where it stays. You don't become more intelligent, intellectually intelligent. You use it more or less, but you stay at the same level. Your EQ is something very different. This is really the way in which you function, the way you understand how you influence and impact other people and yourself. Your EQ is learnable. It actually grows throughout your life to the age of about 50. Now, my husband, when he was 50, I told him, look, it goes up till you're about 50, and then when you reach 50, it goes like this. That's not true, okay? What it does is it goes up and it stays kind of level because you've had so many life experiences by then that that's kind of developed. Now, the latest thing that you can also rank and do tests on is your AQ, which is your adversity quotient. So that looks at how resilient are you? How much are you capable of getting things done? How much can you bounce back? What is your elasticity? So how good are you at that? And you all know how important that is. We all set up on this wonderful path and things do go wrong. Trust me, many things went wrong in our path and they still do. But then you need to be able to get up, learn, and move on. Okay. So what do? All of our senior leaders, they do an EQ test. So this is online, so we've helped them to do all these tests and then give them feedback. And that's where we build their development plans around, to help them become more emotionally intelligent, because that drives a lot of your AQ. So looking at the AQ, so are you resilient or not? There is four things to think about, and I don't know if any of you has read this article here, the Harvard Business Review, The Making of a Corporate Athlete. If you haven't, I would recommend it. It's a very nice article and it basically explains what I'm going to explain to you now. So to be more resilient, there's four areas you need to focus on. And the first one that starts on the top is social or emotional. It's incredibly important that you have good relationships, interpersonal relationships, at work, at home, you have friends around you, you have people you can talk to. Because when things go wrong, you need to get rid of your story and get a different opinion. I have a husband who is the opposite of me, and I can tell you in the beginning that was very difficult, but I have learned a lot. Because he looks at things very differently than I do. And it helps me at home, at work, in my family, my friends. Also mental. So make sure you have a coping mechanism, and that coping mechanism can be anything. It can be sports. If you get stressed, You need to do something to get the stress out of your body. Me personally, I do a lot of sports. Doesn't look like it, but I do. I have a cross trainer at home. I've recently bought something brilliant, an inversion table. Have you ever heard of that? It's a table and you hang upside down. It's amazing, seriously. Because what happens is all your stress goes out of your body, so I recommend that. Inversion table. Regular breaks, also on the mental. You know, there's lots of tools that can help you to break your workday on a regular basis. It's important. Do something that takes your mind away from what you were doing, get refreshed and start again. Physical. And again there, water, food and water. Now, my husband was in the water business, that's why I know a little bit about it. But it's so important you drink sufficiently. Do you know how much you should drink per day? How much? 1.5 liters, 2 liters, I see. Okay, it's a simple calculation. You take your body weight times 0.03. So if you weigh 60 kilos, it's 1.8 liters. If you weigh 70 kilos, it's 2.1 liters. If you weigh more, it's more. And it's water, okay? Not coffee, not beer, not wine, water. Also the importance of food. If you want to be resilient, you need to feed yourself proper food. That you get your vitamins and your minerals. Honestly, you will notice a difference, a huge difference in the way that you can cope. Stand-up desks. And if you have one of those desks that you can lift up and down, brilliant. Yeah, very good to work standing up. I noticed I'm much more concentrated when I do. Much more than when you're sitting in a chair, because you tend to start slouching in a chair. Right. Last but not least, and in business, people always cringe when you say that, spiritual. You need to have a balance there. And what I mean with that there, very simply, your values need to be aligned with the values of your organization. If they're not, it will make you tired, it will make you miserable. And honestly, in our organization, I tell people, if they're not aligned, you need to leave. Because it's not going to make you happy, it's not going to make us happy. So make sure that your values are aligned. So stress and change can be very stressful. Sorry, not stress, change can be very stressful. And I like the quote here from Carl Jung, I'm not what happened to me, I am who I choose to become. That also happens in your day-to-day life in an organization. When something goes wrong, you choose the way you react. You choose whether you get upset or whether you look at it, calmly react, change things and move forward. It's you. And if you can install that belief in your organization, you get a very resilient organization and very resilient individuals. Now, did our efforts pay off? I think so. We do an opinion survey. And last year, when we started this process, we went up by 5 points, which is pretty good. This year, because there was so much happening, we thought we would not maintain it, but we did. So we kept at the same engagement level, which is great. A couple of higher scoring ones, you know, understanding how their role contributes to the overall business. That's huge. If people feel they add value, that is huge for your organization. And also have a clear understanding of Belmont's core values. Very important for us, that people know what they're there for and they know what the company stands for. So I believe that what we did was the right path. Did we make mistakes? Hell yes, we did. But did we then react as a resilient organization? I think we did. And with that, I hope that was useful for everybody.